interpretation. So can we say that once again the journalists got it horribly wrong? That we presumed that Mr. Modi would suffer some kind of a backlash. Instead, he emerged at least in February of 2017 as a kind of a Robin Hood figure in post-demonetization India.
Thanks, Sanjeev. I will try to answer the question that you raised and also pick up on some of the other issues and try not to repeat what you've heard so far or arguments that you've heard. As far as Modi's decision and the logic behind it, I think sometimes the easiest and most obvious explanation is probably the correct one. And in this case, that explanation is that you have a decision taken by a limited number of people in a power structure that represents, to borrow a phrase from Putin, who just got re-elected, a power vertical. So there is no consultation, there is no argument, there is no discussion or debate. And essentially, a decision taken out of ignorance, without any research to back it up, without any careful consideration of any of the factors that Professor Deepak Nair had mentioned about the context in which demonetization has happened in the past. None of this was taken into account in the decision. So, when you have a decision taken in ignorance, you will produce results that are quite unexpected and quite disastrous from an economic point of view. And to my mind, it doesn't surprise me that we have series after series of post-facto rationalizations, new arguments being trotted out, as each rationale appeared to have failed, new rationales were given. And today, by every metric, last week, or the last week of February, the RBI, there was a sliver of hope for the government that cash in circulation, we know that all the money came back, but that cash in circulation was still not as high as what it was in November 2016, and this was the big argument that Jaitley and Mr. Modi and others gave, right? That the percentage of cash, cash as a percentage of GDP was too high. Well, the figures from the RBI last week of February tell us that 99%, so the amount of cash in circulation is back to 99% of the levels of November 8, 2016. And I would imagine that as months go by election time, it will have surpassed that. So even assuming, and it's a bit of a stretch to believe, that a significant chunk of cash in circulation in November 8, 2016 was a flow of black money. Let's assume a certain percentage of that represented the flow of black money. Even if we accept Jay Panda's argument that land, property, various sectors that were cash intensive have taken a hit. The fact that the same amount of cash is back in circulation suggests that maybe transactions are on hold, maybe transactions maybe are happening in a different sort of way. But to assume that the amount of black transactions have come down, to my mind, is not sustained by broad macro evidence. Mr. Modi, in his big speech at the end of December 2016, made what I regard as another fairly plausible argument or a motivation, which was the tax argument, that we want to bring people into the tax net. And he mentioned this figure, that how is it possible that in a country like India, the total number of taxpayers who declare an income of rupees 10 lakh or above is just 24 lakh. It's an absurd figure. It's absurdly low. And if at the end of this process, that figure of 24 lakh people who have an income of 10 lakhs and above increases significantly, that could be an argument. So far, we've seen no evidence. And in any case, there are many more efficient methods of zeroing in on those people. He mentioned the anomaly of the sale of high-end cars and the mismatch between that and high-salaried people, well, it's very easy to track down who the purchasers of these motor cars are and to ensure that they are filing tax returns or mark them down for special audit. By any argument, it seems as if logic doesn't hold, and I return to my, there may be Machiavellian considerations of politics and, you know, foreign hand, etc. I'm not qualified to comment on those. To my mind, ignorance born of very narrow decision making taken in a political structure or an institutional structure which does not favor discussion and debate and questioning and argument, where you have jiuzuri, which is the bane of Indian decision making, magnified 100-fold within the Modi power vertical. It doesn't surprise me that this kind of a decision got taken. And having taken it, you have, and you know, it also represents, and this is, to my mind, we've commented on the economic consequences and how long lasting. I lament the damage that demonetization and the cover-up, in order to somehow show that it was a valid decision, the damage this has done to the right to information, the RBI as an autonomous institution. You have absurd arguments. RTI requests being made to the RBI that please tell us what were the research papers that you consulted before a decision was taken. Who are the people who took this decision? And you get replies saying information is denied because there is a threat to life, or because the national security of India would be compromised. Absurd arguments, which further insult citizens of this country who had to deal with completely unnecessary trauma of the entire money exchange. And it saddens me. Even now when I travel to different parts of India, I meet people, typically old, infirm people who still have old money. You find 2,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees in a drawer. It may not mean a lot to somebody sitting in Delhi. But I met in Uttarakhand, old woman, 3,000 rupees, unable to change it. And to my mind, the violence that this does to the rights of citizens, to political institutions, is something which is far more long-lasting. Final comment I want to make in the context of black money and the campaign against black money is that I find it surprising, shocking, that side by side with this move to fight against black money in this very, very misguided manner, you have Parliament not once but twice amending the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act through a mere footnote of the money in the finance bill to whitewash illegal donations made by foreign companies to political parties in India. In 2014, the High Court in Delhi found the Congress and BJP guilty of illegally accepting money for Vedanta, which is a foreign company under the FCRA. Mr. Jaitley smuggles in an amendment, first in a very ham-handed way, forgetting that those donations came when the old FCRA was in force, and they then had to scramble, and once again in the current finance bill, which was passed without any discussion in Parliament, you have the absurdity of a law which has already been repealed. I'm not sure if this has ever happened in Indian legislative history. A law that has already been repealed is summoned from the graveyard and amended and is sent back to the graveyard, only in order to legitimize donations by foreign companies to political parties, and there's no surprise who are the main beneficiaries of this. And I find it absurd that the Prime Minister or the Finance Minister can talk with a straight face about fighting black money and fighting corruption and talking about having transparency in political funding, when you smuggle in these kinds of provisions, and which, you know, and I'm not even beginning to talk about the electoral bonds. You know, Jasdeep Chopra, others, ADR, have commented and written about this extensively. How, in the name of making things more transparent, you are actually strengthening the sinews of that flow of black money that Professor Nair mentioned. Because black money continues to lubricate and continues to have a presence, and I don't see any forward movement that has been made despite the enormous amount of pain that was exacted on ordinary citizens, as I said, in a decision taken at the end of the day in my books on the basis of zero research, zero facts, and simply an assumption that if we do this measure, somehow black money will be curtailed and perhaps political advantages might flow in terms of signaling what kind of a government the Pradhan Sevak is running.
Thanks very much, Siddharth. In fact, we should at some stage